My name is Lois Donovan. I'm a clinical professor at the University of Calgary, and I specialize in the area of diabetes and pregnancy. I'm talking to you today about the use of time in range in pregnancy. So data from women with type 1 diabetes shows that CGM use improves pregnancy outcomes, and that is increments as small as 5%, so just 70 minutes per day, are associated with less large for gestational age birth weight babies and other improved neonatal outcomes. Use of continuous glucose monitoring in pregnancy has been shown to be cost effective in women with type 1 diabetes in pregnancy in the UK and in Canada, depending on the assumptions that are put into the cost study. It's at least cost neutral, and by some assumptions, cost effective as well. How do I apply this to my clinical practice? I'm going to share with you some tips that I use. The concept study has shown us that starting continuous glucose monitoring in pregnancy is safe and effective in women with type 1 diabetes. It's important not to limit continuous glucose monitoring just to insulin pump users, as multiple daily injection users benefit as much or more as the insulin pump users. Can be very helpful to confirm low blood sugars when using continuous glucose monitoring. And that's that regardless of the manufacturer of the continuous glucose sensor, there seems to be an influence of compressing that sensor lying on it overnight. And so sometimes we will see lower overnight blood sugars that are not necessarily true. So it can be especially important to confirm the lows overnight. And sometimes, depending on the type of continuous glucose sensor you're using, consider setting lower targets if the woman is plagued by unnecessary alarms that are not true lows in the middle of the night. The other thing that I found CGM particularly helpful with in pregnancy is it gives both myself and those using it a greater confidence in pre-meal bolusing. And that's important as pregnancy progresses, particularly when you get into the third trimester, particularly at the supper meal. The other piece of information that continuous glucose monitoring gives you is the tracing curve of how the blood sugar is responding to the changes that you make. So when I see someone who's having a lot of very high 1 hour post-meal elevations, really the best way to get after that is to adjust the amount of carbohydrate in that meal that we're seeing high 1 hour post-meal elevations, or the timing of the insulin bolus. Changing the amount of the insulin bolus doesn't have much of an effect on the 1 hour post-meal elevation. It does on the 2 hour post-meal elevation. But if you're going after the 1 hour post-meal elevation by simply increasing your dose of insulin, you may end up with low blood sugar 2, 3, 4 hours after your meal bolus. The rate of changeovers can be particularly helpful with real-time insulin adjustments to prevent or for prevention of hypoglycemia or prevention of hyperglycemia for that matter. But it is important to educate people using this device not to overreact to changes right after they've made a bolus. So if they've had a meal and they see their blood sugar going up 15 minutes after, you don't want them to be doing changes. A safe rule of thumb is do not make corrections in response to what you're seeing on your CGM until 2 hours after your last bolus. In pregnancy, there is some study that has shown that CGM wear on the back of the arm may be the best site to wear the sensor in terms of accuracy. The other thing to keep in mind is that the reports that you get, you may or may not be able to change the time and range to pregnancy time and range. So keep that in mind as a limitation of the reports that you're getting This differs between the different manufacturers of CGM devices. Thank you very much. I hope you find this information helpful as you care for your women with diabetes in pregnancy. For more information, please visit the American Diabetes Association Time and Range website at professional.diabetes.org/timeandrange.